The other continuous approaches for measuring carbonyl compounds are mostly just for looking at one carbonyl compound, aldehyde. There is a commercial analyzer for looking, making continuous measurements of aldehyde. There's a version for atmospheric sampling, which is what this one is, and then also measure of water. It's a derivatization reaction and fluorescent detection. This technique is used quite a bit in Germany. This shows intercomparison between techniques for measuring formaldehyde. All of these techniques up at the top are using the same kind of system. Here is differential optical absorption of open path spectroscopic technique of TIR measurements. Here, this is differential optical absorption of orange with this continuous analyzer in blue. The top has five different continuous analyzers that are sampling the same variable, same kind of problem. So the system works fairly well for formaldehyde. It's been used in a variety of additional studies as well. This shows an application in the Houston area. These are measurements at three different sites in Houston. The MT site is an urban site. The other two sites are industrial sites in the Houston area. Between 5,000 and 6,000 measurements at each of these sites during a 2-month time period. One can measure fairly high concentration, up to 30 to 50 parts per billion. The median concentration is in the 3 to 6 parts per billion range for these samples. And these are all hourly measurements. No, these are 10-minute measurements and then 2-3 hour averages. This system is measuring just one compound from aldehyde by a derivatization technique. And so you can get better time resolution. The technique's been applied a fair amount in Houston to look at formaldehyde sources. And this particular paper is trying to sort out primary versus secondary sources of formaldehyde by looking at how formaldehyde concentrations are related to other tracers, carbon monoxide, peroxyacetyl nitrate, which is a secondary glue, so part of formaldehyde that is related to this should be the chemically generated formaldehyde, and then there's a small part that's related to the SO2, which is another industrial source. So this shows the partitioning between vehicle-related formaldehyde, from the CO, from the chemically produced, and industrial produced formaldehyde in a simple way. This particular study didn't do much comparison with other approaches. My group has been working on developing a system like this for weigh gas in sample, we sample the air through the diffusion scrubber, so we're then transferring the formaldehyde from the air to the liquid, and we measure the flow rate of the gas that we're sampling through the system. We can also remove formaldehyde from the air by passing it through a cartridge that will scrub formaldehyde and the carbonyl compounds from the air before it goes into the diffusion scrubber. We do this cycle back and forth between ambient air and zero air, 10 minutes every hour, so we have a baseline information with background fluorescence signal looks like on a continuous basis. On the solution side, through the diffusion scrubber, we pass an acidifying solution that formaldehyde will dissolve in, then we can add to that the volatilizing reagent after the scrubber. This goes to a heated reaction chamber, so it will react for a few minutes at about 60 C before going through a bubble trap and through a fluorescence detector. So we're just looking at fluorescence that is formed in the reaction. This shows a picture of the scrubber. It's like the diffusion scrubbers we've seen in previous diagrams and so we put to it on the series. So it improves the collection efficiency, lab inclusion of the instruments is less. The computer that is controlling this shows injection of various levels of standard, and the data is each of these is a 1 hour cycle, so there's 50 minutes of an hour over collecting sample, there's a 10 minute zero period between these samples. So we're injecting a series of standards at different gas phase equivalent concentrations. This is looking at a calibration curve from roughly 0 to 4 parts per billion. Plenty of signal. Occasionally you will see a bubble that seeps through that has to remove the data set from the average. This is the average signal for this roughly 50 minutes fairly stable signal. And it's corrected for the background, the baseline versus the amount of work that's measuring it is a necessity of the current system. This is the instrument sample here from the lab for a 3 day period of time. And so we're just looking at what we're having to be around in a lab. There shouldn't be 400 in the same lab that we try to keep those things, all carbonyl compounds out. So you see some variation in concentration. The major reason for doing this experiment is to figure out what the problems are of operating the instrument continuously. So this was running continuously for a 3 day period of time. There's 1 hour of the day that a span measurement on the system automatically so that our data is submitted since it is not a sample. So this is air samples, hourly averages to air sample for a 3 day period of time. So this kind of an approach will work. Commercial versions of this that are available now. One can measure formaldehyde on a continuous basis, certainly with that input sensitivity. We'll see in some of the other work that I'll talk about the same formaldehyde techniques they've used for a number of other applications. But it works in the downside is it only takes one. But it is a good time resolution. Some of the experiments that we'll see later take advantage of that time resolution to understand some of the issues with it.